Good morning, Facebook. We are going to bring in YouTube. And good morning, YouTube. YouTube, we are having problems with you. We're going to try again. Technical difficulties. But good morning, Facebook. It's good to see all of you. Thank you for worshiping with us today. We're going to do things a little differently today than we have started our service before. Normally, when we meet together, we would have a time of greeting and welcome, which we're not able to do in our current setting. But what I would love to see you guys do is if, as you're on Facebook with us, if you just drop a note and say, hi, how you doing? Good morning. Let us know where you are and where you're worshiping from with us today. I'm typing really fast and trying to get us back on YouTube. And just say hi to everyone. We're working on everything to see what we're going to do here. I think we're just going to go live on Facebook and we'll post to YouTube later. So good morning, everyone. Let's connect. Good to see where you're from, where everybody is worshiping with today. If you've got a cup of coffee, you can say that as well. It's great to be with you. We've got a great time of worship planned. And with that, now I'm going to turn things over to Lindsay as she comes to lead us in worship.
Good morning. We're going to be singing four songs today, and the lyrics were already scheduled to post on the Facebook page. So our first song this morning is going to be hymn number 187, In the Garden.
Calling on my ear.
Our next song this morning is going to be Difference Maker.
He climbs up.
right quick, we're going to try to get our YouTube audience back. This is the fun of live worship, everybody. Sometimes we have glitches. We're going to try to bring in our YouTube crew and say good morning to them as well. While we're doing this, I want to encourage you today, if you haven't gotten a chance and you're in the area, it is a beautiful day outside. The sun is shining. It's a little colder than I wish it was, but we're just excited about the beautiful sunshine and just so excited that you have chosen to spend some of your Sunday morning with us. And it looks like we have been live on YouTube the entire time. So this is the fun again of live worship, but we're so glad to have you with us. We're going to turn it back over to Lindsay for our next song.
Our next song is Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Please join us. Wasteland that Kyle and I both kind of wanted to do today. So if you know it, sing along or join us later on. The words are on Facebook and YouTube.
Wasteland where I'm living.
going to take a second to switch places.
Well, good morning again. Like I said a while ago, it is great to connect with you. I know we're having a few glitches. YouTube, if you're with us, we will be posting another video later to kind of correct the messed up stream here, but it's so great to worship. You know, I told Alma a while ago that I was hoping to have a little fun today. To felt like we're at the stage in the game where we've passed through a lot. There's been a lot going on in our lives and in all of our different experiences, that we need to just take a collective breath and smile a little bit today and laugh a little and have a little bit of fun with what we are doing as we worship together. So everything is you know, still in flux, still changing. I believe good days are ahead as things are progressing, but here we are together. And so as we meet together the last Sunday after Easter, I want to share a word from you from the end of Mark's gospel, which is Mark 16, verses 9 through 20, which most manuscripts don't record as being a part of the original ending of Mark. But we're going to spend some time exploring that today, have a little fun with it. But also, the reason I want us to dive into it is because I really think that there is a great nugget of truth in the midst of this as we explore this extra ending to Mark's gospel. But before we do that, let's read it together, and then we're going to have a time of prayer, and then we'll explore it. So pray with. Let's dive into Mark 16, verses 9 through 20 together. When Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, he appeared first to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had driven seven demons. She went and told those who had been with him and who were mourning and weeping. When they heard that Jesus was alive and that she had seen him, they did not believe it. Afterward, Jesus appeared in a different form to two of them while they were traveling in the country. These returned and reported it to the rest, but they didn't believe them either. Later, Jesus appeared to the 11 as they were eating. He rebuked them for their lack of faith and their stubborn refusal to believe those who had seen him after he had risen. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will drive out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up snakes with their hands, and when they drink deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people and they will get well." Now, after the Lord Jesus had spoken to them, he was taken up into heaven and he sat on the right hand of God. Then the disciples went out and preached everywhere, and the Lord worked with them and confirmed his words by the sign that accompanied it. All right, let's pray together. Lord Jesus, we love you. We thank you so much for this opportunity to worship together today. God, we ask that you would speak to our hearts, that you would challenge us, that you would encourage us. God, that you would help us to find a way forward. We love you and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So what do you do when the rest of the story isn't the rest of the story? I bring that up because years ago, back in the heyday of radio, there was a talk radio guy by the name of Paul Harvey. And if you remember Paul Harvey, he would always tell a story and then he would go and do some other things in his program, or he'd come back later in the day for the rest of the story. Now, as I said last week, the Gospel of Mark ends rather abruptly. A lot of people think it ends so abruptly because we've lost the ending. Others think it was a literary device. But what most people agree on is that what is there in verses 9 through 20 wasn't the original ending at all. In fact, they believe it was added much later. So what do you do with that? What do you do as you're reading through Scripture and you find something that's added later? Is there something that it can still say to us? Is there a word of encouragement? Is there a challenge in it, even though it was added later? Can God still speak? We're going to answer these questions today as we explore this, and we're going to answer the question that even though this was added later, does it have some important information for us about Jesus' disciples? And does it say something about Jesus calling them and giving them this second charge in the midst of where he finds them? We're going to explore this together as we dive in to Mark 16, 9 through 20. That says that when Jesus rose early on the first day, he appeared to Mary Magdalene, the lady who he had cast seven demons out of. And she was so excited, she went and she told Jesus' disciples. But they didn't believe her. Then Jesus appeared to several other of his disciples who happened to be walking in the country away from Jerusalem. And when he revealed himself to them, they returned immediately and they told the disciples, the 11. And yet they still didn't believe until sometime later, Jesus appeared to them directly while they were eating and rebuked them for their unbelief and for their doubting and for their stubbornness. And then he said, okay, here we go. Now I'm calling you to go into all of the world and preach the gospel. To go and share with people what I've done for them. Baptize them if they believe. Because if they believe, they'll be saved. But if they reject me, they won't. And you will know that there are signs that I'm with you in the sense that if you come encounter with poisonous snakes and they bite you, they will not hurt you. You will drive out demons. You will speak in tongues. You will heal the sick. You will do all of these things in my name. Then this later ending of Mark says that Jesus ascended and went back to heaven. And after Jesus had left, the disciples went out into all the world and shared the gospel. Okay, so this is the added ending to Mark 16. I spent a lot of time researching this week because it's a great mystery. Where does this thing come from? It's not a part of the earliest manuscript. In fact, a lot of scholars have dated this ending of the Gospel of Mark to at least the second century before it started circulating with the rest of the Gospel. Some dated it a little later, but it's a great mystery. And when I study scripture, one of the things that I really enjoy, because I'm a history nut and I just love mysteries, is when you come across a passage like this that you can tell is added later by an editor, you have to go, wait a minute, does it have spiritual significance? It's present in scripture, but is it on the same level? And you know what's fascinating? Depending upon who you read, and I read a lot of folks researching it this week, you find a lot of different opinions. Some folks, like the great Baptist scholar of yesteryear, Herschel Hobbes, stops at verse 8 of Mark 16 and says, hey, the rest of this, I don't really know what to do with it because I've looked at the Greek and it's not a part of the original scripture. It was added later. Others say, you know what? It was added later, and it definitely, you can tell that it's not linked to Mark in the way that he originally wrote his gospel, in the sense that there are 33 words in the Greek that are used in this short collection of verses that are not used throughout the rest of Mark's gospel. There's just a lot of stylistic differences, in the sense that if, you know what I'm talking about, if you've read one specific author before, You can pick out his style from a crowd. And, you know, if you you're reading something that's written by a particular author, you know, popular ones that come to mind, guys like Michael Crichton, Tom Clancy, Neil Gaiman, Stephen King, all of these folks have different specific styles. If you're a fan of historical works, David McCullough is a good one to think about. All of these guys have their own voice that is very unique to them. And you can tell when someone else is writing and it's not them. It's the same way that scholars have discovered that this ending of Mark doesn't flow with the rest because it doesn't sound like the original voice in which the scripture was written. So it's very different in its style, in its presentation, also in its references, in terms of some of the things that it brings up when Jesus is sending out the people. When he's sending out his disciples to go into the world and to preach, he talks about this idea about driving out demons, which is something that Jesus did, and he said, you would do these things in my name, but that's consistent. But then you start getting into the idea of speaking in tongues or speaking in other languages. Now, this is certainly something that the Holy Spirit did in the early church. However you want to look at that, whether you're talking about an ecstatic prayer language or you're talking about the supernatural gifting of people's ability to converse and to speak to people in a different language that's referenced in Acts chapter 2, that's present in the work of the early church. That's part of the Holy Spirit beginning to stretch and grow those who had been sent out by Jesus. So that's there, but it's there much later. It's not, this is not something that Jesus spoke about. This is something that the Holy Spirit did in the church during its early formation time after Christ went back to heaven. And then you also have this idea of picking up snakes and then biting them. Now, this is a piece that we really need to unplug and dive into, for the simple fact that there is a lot of crazy theology that has come out of Mark 16 with this whole idea of picking up snakes. If you're familiar with the certain sect of Christianity, even very, 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 very independent Baptist in certain mountain areas of our country who pick up snakes as a sign of their faith, this is where they get that idea from. And that's a very prime example of how we should not ever build our doctrine or build a practice on one verse in Scripture. We need to look at Scripture from, you know, in big chunks. We need to look at the things that we are seeing that are important and take a step back and say, wait a minute, is this something that all of Scripture speaks about? Because there have been certain Christians who I think were well-meaning but horribly misguided who said, wait a minute, this says pick up snakes, so we need, this needs to be a part of our regular worship service. And if you're interested and you have free time, I can't remember which program it was. I believe it was NBC Dateline years ago did a fascinating expose about these snake handling churches. And I haven't looked at it yet, but I'm pretty sure you can find it on YouTube. But you can watch this program. Now, I have firsthand experience about these four kinds of churches from my seminary background, in the sense that one of my professors went to school in Kentucky where his professors were studying this small group of churches that felt like God had called them to handle snakes during their worship service. And when I, years ago, our professor in class told us one day of his experience in his seminary days, that his professors had gone up to study this, and they actually went and they filmed a whole worship service with this snake handling church. And in the midst of it, they said they got to watch the whole program in class. And so this is back in the 80s when cameras were things you had to hold on your shoulders. They were massive, and they still had the old VHS tapes inside. Nothing like what I'm using right now to share with you. Which, just for reference point, the camera that I'm speaking into right now is not even the length of a credit card. So, I mean, this thing was massive and it was heavy. And my professor said, as they watched this church service in class, that it seemed like any other small town country church service that you'd ever seen or ever been a part of until the very end when the snakes came out. And not only could you tell a difference in what was happening from the pulpit as the deacons and the pastor began to handle and dance with snakes, but his own professor's filming of it suddenly began to shake as he went, oh my gosh! You know, he was terrifying. Now, as I said, we have to be super careful. Anytime we pull something from Scripture, we pull one verse and try to frame a doctrine or a practice or a reason behind we do things. And snake handling is absolutely one of those things. Because even though this is not necessarily an original part of Mark's gospel, and that it's an added ending, by no means is the editor who sought to finish Mark's gospel, to give it a whole completed ending. In no way was he advocating that people should go and handle poisonous snakes as a sign of his faith, or their faith. So what is he saying then? What is he referencing? Well, most likely, he's referencing the shipwreck that happens in Acts 28 when Paul is on his way to Rome and he gets shipwrecked and on the Isle of Malta and he's bitten by a viper. And Paul doesn't die. He shakes the viper off into the fire. And at first, people think it's a sign that he's a god, but in all reality, Paul says, no, I'm just a man, but God has protected me. That is what the second author or editor of Mark is trying to communicate, is the Holy Spirit is at work. And this is how you know that the followers of Christ have been empowered. One of the many ways is they were given the ability to cast out demons. They were given the ability to communicate with those who did not speak their language so that they could share the gospel. They were given protection from God in the sense that when poisonous snakes or they encountered dangers as they were going out to share the gospel, that they were kept safe. And this is a reference not to the fact we should be dancing with snakes, but that we should know that God is protecting us, that God is with us. And then he also talks about how he will place their hands on people and they will heal them. Again, these are things that are referenced in the book of Acts. Both Peter and John, and later the Apostle Paul, as the good doctor Luke tells us as we go through the book of Acts, mention that the Holy Spirit gave them the ability at times to heal people. A key example, if you look at the early chapters of the book of Acts, where Peter and John are going into the temple to pray, that there's a beggar on the outside, and they ask him for money, and Peter says, I don't have any money, but what I do have is in the name of Jesus, get up and walk. And the man is made well. There are several stories along the same lines with the Apostle Paul. One of my favorites is as Paul is getting ready to go back to Jerusalem and face his opposition that will ultimately lead to his arrest, he spends the night preaching to a specific church. He preaches all night long, and there happens to be a young man who is in a window. And he falls asleep and falls out and dies. And Paul goes and raises the man from the dead, heals him by the power of the Holy Spirit. And all of these things are references that you find at the end of Mark, and they're references to the early church, which helps us understand that this was probably written later. Now, does that mean that the person who composed this ending was trying to be a heretic or tack on to Scripture? No. He's just trying to bring the gospel to an end because it ends abruptly. And if you read verse 8 at the end, it does sound rather abrupt, as we spoke about last week. So those are the references, those are the clues that we can see that this ending of Mark is written much later. Okay, so what's there that is common with the other gospel presentations that we find? Well, we see references to Jesus interacting with the women who have come to the empty tomb, specifically Mary. There is a mention of the men that Jesus appeared to on the road to Emmaus. There's also a reference to the fact that Jesus later appeared to the other 11. Now, this ending of Mark is very harsh because it talks about the fact that the disciples doubted. That every report they heard, they doubted. They weren't sure if Jesus had truly risen from the dead. Now, here's the commonality that you find from Matthew and Luke and John, even with this later ending in Mark. They all reference the fact that after all of these things happen, as they begin to have these reports, the tomb is empty, the women return, the travelers from Emmaus come, there is still this kernel of doubt and disbelief and inability to completely understand that Jesus has risen from the dead, present in his disciples. Now let me tell you why that's good news for all of us. That's good news for us because A lot of times we read the stories about the disciples, and we certainly read the book of Acts, and we see all of these different ways that God was at work in the early church, and people were responsive to the Holy Spirit, and people were coming to faith in droves, by big crowds. And so many of us, we think, oh man, if we were just like the early church, if we just had their faith, God could use us to do amazing things. The good news is, we are like the early church in so many ways, because just like them, we are human beings. We struggle with doubt. We struggle with our inability sometimes to see what God is doing and how God is working in our hearts and in our minds, and how He is stretching us and growing us. And we can get discouraged by that if we look back at Scripture and we miss the fact of what all four Gospels seem to hint at with the resurrected Jesus. That the tomb is empty, Jesus has appeared, the risen Jesus is standing in front of the 11 disciples, and they still don't get it. They're still struggling with disbelief, they're still struggling with doubt, they're still afraid. And the great hope in all of this that we really need to hold on to is that in spite of their imperfections, in spite of their doubt, in spite of all of these different emotions that are swirling in them that you would think would disqualify these people from going to share the gospel, Jesus' words to them are not, all right, come on, guys, for real. Come on. I mean, this really, you're the guys I'm going to send out to preach the gospel? No, I'm going to go call other people. Jesus doesn't do that. Jesus meets these guys right where they are, and gals, because there's the 11, but there's also the other women and other folks who have followed Jesus. And He says to them, go out, make disciples of all people, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them everything, teach them to obey all that I've commanded you. Jesus gives the great commission to these people who are struggling, who are doubting, who have bad attitudes sometimes, who still quite don't understand everything that Christ has shared with them. And that ought to give us hope, because this group of broken people whom Jesus sent out to go and preach the gospel and to reach people, they were imperfect. They were broken. They were still growing and becoming the people that Jesus had created them to be. And they changed the world. So what does that mean for you? What does that mean for me? In the midst of everything going on right now, where we're struggling with a lot of emotions, we're struggling with doubt, we're struggling with fear, we're struggling with an inability to know what the future holds for us. And the question remains, can God use someone like us? Can God use people like us right now, right where we are, in this situation that we find ourselves, with stay-at-home orders, with social distancing? Can God still use us to share the good news of Jesus Christ? And the answer is, yes. Yes, He can. The rest of the story for us is that God is doing something new. In the midst of a time where it feels like a giant emergency brake has been pulled on our lives, the Great Commission, the call that the risen Jesus gave to His 11 disciples, this ragtag, broken group of people who still had doubts, who still didn't get it all, Jesus said, go. Teach people, share the hope of Christ, and know that I am with you. And you're going to do great things, because I'm at work in you. I want you to know today that Jesus is saying the same thing to us. Sometimes we don't understand everything. We're still on that faith journey. We all are. Sometimes we have bad attitudes. Sometimes we're afraid. Sometimes we feel ill-equipped to share the hope of Christ with others. And yet still, Jesus says, no, I'm calling you, not the person behind you, but you. You go. You go into all the world and share the gospel. And you might say, but Jesus, how can I go into all the world when I can't leave my house? And Jesus says, welcome to the 21st century. And I've given you the world wide web. It is wild too. The world wide web. I've given you the internet. I've given you the ability to connect with people in ways that you other people haven't. For a time such as this, Jesus is calling us to go. Even if going doesn't involve moving, even if going involves connecting electronically, that's where we are right now. But again, obstacles are opportunities. And I want to tell you that Sunday after Easter, we have an opportunity to live out the rest of the story, to know that God is not done with us. God's not done telling the story of our church, that He's not done with our lives, that He's sending us out to share the hope of His Son Jesus, because He is the hope of the world. I know right now we're talking about hopes and cures for viruses and all of these things that are whirling around COVID-19. And I want to tell you that the time is going to come where we're going to get this thing under control. It's going to happen. But I want to tell you that even after this passes, the greatest need we have is not for a vaccine. The greatest need we have is not for our lives to return to normal. The greatest need we have is to know Jesus and to experience His love that gives us hope and stability in times like this and equips us to be people to tell others of how Jesus has changed our lives. That's our greatest need. And all we have to do is ask. So we're going to close the day with a word of prayer. And I just want to thank you again for connecting with us. We're going to be uploading this to YouTube in just a few minutes as well. So if the YouTube broadcast went kind of awry today, we'll work that, iron out all those wrinkles. YouTube audience, this will be up in a minute. Sorry that things went wacky live today. But we're just, as we close, I just want to thank you for, again, being a part of this. I want to encourage you to know that God loves you and that He is at work in your life. He's not done with you. I want to challenge you and encourage you, if this has been a source of encouragement, one of the ways that you can connect and share hope is to share this message with others. Share it with your friends on Facebook. Get the word out that we're here, that God loves them and we want to connect with them. Another way that you can connect with us is, as I said at the beginning of the broadcast, say hi in the comments or just let us know where you're worshiping with us. We want to get to know you and connect with you. If you're new, if you're a part of our church family and have, we would love to know that you've been here today so that we can continue to connect. I want to thank all of you who are continuing to contribute to the ministry of our church. We are still, as we have been, able to receive contributions via mail. You can also connect with us via PayPal at sevenlocksbaptistchurch.org. Click the donate button on the top menu. You can contribute in that way even if you don't have a PayPal account. But we just thank you. However the Lord leads you to connect with us, we're just glad you're here. We're glad that we can share the hope of the gospel with you and encourage you in this time. And thank you for being a part of our church family and connecting with us. We will be back again Wednesday night at 6:30 for our Wednesday night prayer and devotion. I hope that you can make plans to join us for that or catch it later on during your week. But the rest of the story, as I said, is God is at work with us right now. God is using you right where you are, and He's sending you out. Jesus loves you, and He has plans for you. Let's pray together. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this time of worship today. God, we ask that you would help us to know that you are still writing the rest of our story, that you're still at work in our lives, and you can still use us to share the gospel even from our own homes. We love you, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. I love all of you, and I will see you Wednesday night at 6:30. goodbye, so long, Facebook, and have a